Hey guys, it's Chris at Highline Guitars. Welcome back to my YouTube guitar building channel. In today's episode, I'm going to give you kind of a brief overview of the 26 different operations that I have to complete in order to cut out a guitar. And that includes the fretboard, the neck, and the body, as well as a truss rod cover and a control cavity cover. Now, I'm not going to go into explicit detail for each process. I'm going to save that for some future videos. What I plan to do is do some videos where I will talk about how I make each part and the bits that are used, the feeds and speeds, the cam strategies and that sort of thing. But for now, I just want to give an overview of the whole process so you can kind of get a feel for what's involved. So let's jump in on the computer and we'll get started. What you see here is one of my project files that I have set up for making one of my guitar designs. And in this case, it's the Bravo single cut guitar. And this project file contains all the different operations that I will need to perform to make the entire guitar. That includes the fretboard, the neck, and the body, as well as a couple of additional pieces such as the truss rod cover and the control cavity cover. And I've set these up. If you look at the bottom of the screen, you'll see there are all these pages lined up here. There's 26 of them in total. Each one of these pages represents a different carving operation necessary to build this guitar. And to get to this point, I have to go through my CAD and my CAM process. So let's jump over to Adobe Illustrator. And what you see here is the top-down, full-size, full-scale view of the Bravo guitar body. And if you look closely, you'll see that there is elements for a arm contour, a belly contour, front, top, and back contours where the neck meets the body, neck pocket, pickup pockets, as well as the control cavity. And what I'll do is I will save the elements that can be carved using a two-dimensional carving strategy as SVG files. And then the elements that need to be carved using a three-dimensional carving strategy, I'll just save out as Adobe Illustrator. And then the SVG files are brought back into the file that I've created for the guitar itself. And this is all being set up in Easel Pro, which is the software that Inventables has developed to work with their X-Carve CNC machines. And what I've done is I've brought in, here's an example. What we're looking at on the left side of the screen is the elements for my fretboard. And this includes the marker dots as well as the slot for the nut. And these are just two-dimensional carving files. So I can just drop those SVG files into an easel, and then I can select my bit, establish my feeds and speeds, and it's ready to carve. And I've also done that as well with the fret slots. So I'll get to that more in just a second. But we'll jump back here into Illustrator. The elements that are going to be carved using a 3D strategy, meaning they have contours, those elements are then imported into Rhinoceros. And then I use those elements to build a 3D model of the component. In this case, obviously, it's the Bravo body. And you can see I have rounded edges as well as this arm relief contour, a belly relief contour, and then the front, top, and back contours where the neck meets the body for easy access to the upper frets. These are all three-dimensional shapes. So once I've created the 3D model, I can then save it as an STL file. And then I can import that into MeshCam, which is what you see here. This is the same body in MeshCam. And what I've done is I've established my stock dimensions as well as added some supports to keep the body from flying around when it's being carved out. And then what I can do in MeshCam is select my tools
and the feeds and speeds, which can then be used once I'm satisfied I have the right tool pathing strategy here. I can save that out as a G-code file. And then once I've saved out the G-code file, I can jump back into Easel, and then I can import the G-code files to carve the body. So Easel is not only used as a CAM strategy developing program, but it's also a G-code sender. So once I have these files set up, I can then proceed with carving them out on my CNC machine. So Easel becomes the G-code sending program. So when I've got everything ready to go, the overview that I'd like to explain is that I'll start out by making the fretboard, and I'll make it all the way to completion, from a blank to a fretboard that's ready to accept frets. So I'll start with the fret marker dots, and I'll drill those in. And once that's done, this will take about 2 minutes. If you look at the lower right corner here, you see the play button and the pause and all that. It'll take about 2 minutes to drill these holes and to cut that slot for the nut. Then I'll move on to doing the fret slots. And if we jump back into Illustrator, the fret slots, I have an entire file which includes the slots for the frets, the marker dots. At the very bottom, you can see a little template that represents the fretboard radius. And these are the elements that I use. And I'll bring those in as SVG files into Easel. And here I've got the fret slots set up and ready to carve. And I'll carve those out with a 0.024 inch diameter two flute spiral bit. And they're cut to a depth of about 0.125, which is about an eighth of an inch deep, or whatever the depth of the fret tang is that I'm using. And I know that with CNC, theoretically, you should be able to match the radius of the fretboard when cutting the slots so that the bottom of the slot is radius to match the radius of the fretboard. However, the process of setting that up is very complicated. And in my case, I would have to write G-code to do that. And I have decided that it's just not worth the effort. It would take a lot of work to do it. And once I got it done, I would have to ask myself the question, did I really accomplish anything? And in my experience, I wouldn't. So I don't even bother. I just cut a straight slot. And the cool thing is these slots and just short of the edge of the fretboard. And that means you can't see the slots from the side of the fretboard. They call it a blind fret slot. I'm not sure why, because in truth, all fret slots are blind. They don't have eyes. But regardless, you can't feel or see the slots from the side. Anyways, once the slots are cut, the next step is to carve the radius of the fretboard. And this is an imported G-code file that I created in MeshCAM. And to carve the radius, I'm going to be using a half-inch diameter round nose bit to get the smoothest possible surface. And this will take about 14 minutes to cut the radius. Once that's done, I have to switch bits again back to my quarter-inch bit, which I then use to cut the perimeter shape of the fretboard. And at this stage, the fretboard is complete. I can remove it from the wasteboard on the CNC machine and prepare for carving the neck. So to do that, I would then place a neck blank on the wasteboard, which in this case is a 4-inch wide. It's about a 2-inch tall, 1.84-inch tall, 30-inch long blank. And it can be maple, mahogany, whatever. And the first operation will be to cut the truss rod slot, which you see here. And this operation takes 3 minutes to carve that out. And once that's done, I can then proceed with the face of my headstock. Now, my headstocks are angled, so I will be carving just the face of the headstock. And this is actually a two carving operations combined into one. There's a rough carving operation with my quarter inch two flute bit that hogs out most of the wood, but it leaves kind of a terraced stair step surface. And then to clean that up and smooth it out, I use the same bit and perform just a finishing operation, which will smooth it out and get the surface really close to being ready for finish. Then at this stage, I can then flip the blank over on the waste board, clamp it back down, and carve the back contours. And this includes the back of the headstock, the back contour of the neck, as well as the heel. And again, this is going to incorporate several different operations, but these operations have to be separate because each of the operations involves a different bit. So the first we'll use my quarter inch bit, and that's the rough carving operation, which will hog out most of the wood. Then I'll switch bits to a half inch diameter round nose bit and use that to do the finishing operation, which makes the neck nice and smooth. And then from there, I can switch back to my quarter inch bit and I'll do a perimeter cut. And what this does is it helps to smooth out the edges, which tend to be still kind of rough even after the finishing operation. So this will smooth those out. And from this stage, the neck is completely finished. And what I can do is cut the tabs, liberate it from the blank, drop in the truss rod itself, and then glue the fretboard into place. And then once that's dry, I can then press in my frets. From there, I'm ready to start carving the body of the guitar. And when I carve the body, I always start with the back. And I'll start by cutting the control cavity. And to do that, what I'm going to be using is a couple of different operations. The first will make use of a quarter inch diameter two flute down cut bit. And this just basically cuts into the surface. And the reason that I do this with a down cut bit to start with is it leaves the edge nice and smooth with no tear out and no fuzzies. With an upcut bit, you get all those fuzzy edges and the potential for tear out. Some woods tear out worse than others, so I just always make it a point to use the down cut bit to get the cut started. This will only take a minute. And once that's done, I can switch to my upcut bit, which does a better job of evacuating the chips as it's carving a deep cavity. And this is what I use to cut the remaining depth of the cavity. And if you look closely, you can see the three circles in the bottom. Those are slightly deeper into the wood. And what that does is it gives me a slightly thinner dimension between the inside top of the cavity and the outside top of the body so that I have enough, or I can get enough of my shaft of my pot to extend through without making it too thin overall. So I just kind of thin out just those circle areas where the pots and the switches will be mounted. Once this is done, I can then proceed with carving the back contours. And again, I'm going to be using a couple of different operations, starting with a rough carving strategy that you see here using my quarter inch two flute upcut bit in this case. And then once this is done, this takes about 10 minutes, I'll switch over to a half inch diameter round nose bit and do my finishing carve here. And this will smooth out the surface that was left during the rough carve. Now, one of the problems with finishing strategies is there are multiple strategies that you can use. And unfortunately, there isn't one size fits all strategy that is going to give you a perfect surface. What you have to do typically is combine carving operations. And so what I had to do here, I noticed when I simulated this that there was some rough surface in part of this belly relief area. So I added a second finishing pass, which will smooth that out. So you have to kind of, one of the things that I like to do is I use a program called Camotics, and I'll open that up here. And what this does is it allows you to simulate the carving of your G-code. So what you can do, I'll see if I can do this, is you can open up a G-code file. I may have to go back to an earlier design. So let's see what we have here. Here's a contours file. And what this does is it shows you a simulation of what it's going to look like when it carves. And this helps you to determine where there may be some problems. And if you see those problems in the simulation, you can then go back and refine your carving operation to include a more advanced finishing strategy. The last operation for cutting the back is a perimeter cut. And what I'm doing is I'm running my quarter inch two flute spiro bit all the way around the perimeter of the body. You might think I'm cutting all the way through, however, I'm not. And this is really important to understand. Because of the contours in this body, I can't place tabs at the very bottom that link the body to the blank. Now, of course, tabs are used to keep the blank from flying around as you cut through the wood. It keeps the part stable and clamped to the workpiece, so it stays in position while you carve. However, because there are contours on both the front and the back, I can't put tabs down at the very bottom on either side. So what I have to do is place the tabs at the very center of the body's thickness or the blank's thickness. And as a result, when I do this perimeter carve, it's only going halfway through, or roughly halfway through, the blank. And it will smooth out the edges and make them nice and clean. However, it won't go all the way through. So I'll do the same operation, which you'll see in a minute, from the other side, the front side, but it leaves the tabs intact so that the body doesn't go flying around. Once this is done, I can then flip the blank over and proceed with carving the front operations. And this starts out with a shallow cut for the pickup cavities, the neck cavity, and I'll also drill the holes for my controls. Now, as you can see here, this first carve is only about an eighth of an inch deep, and just like the control cavity on the back, I'm doing this with a spiral down cut bit to make sure that the edges are nice and crisp and clean. And then once this is done, this will take about a minute, I'll switch bits to my upcut bit, my quarter inch upcut bit, and that will be used to carve the finished depth for those pockets. And this operation will take about 6 minutes. And once that's done, I can then proceed with carving the perimeter and contours. And again, I'm going to be using a couple of different bits, and I'll be using a rough cutting strategy as well as a couple of finishing strategies. And here you're seeing the rough cut strategy. Now you're probably wondering, what is the difference between the colors in these lines? Well, the blue lines is the actual carving operation. That's the movement of the spindle or the bit across the surface. The red lines are when the bit is retracted above the work surface and then rapidly moved to another portion to continue the carving operation. Those are known as rapid moves. So that's what the difference is there. But once I have this rough carving operation complete, I'll switch bits to my half inch diameter round nose bit and proceed with my finishing operation here. And this will smooth out the surface and get it nice and clean. However, as I had noticed when examining the results in my CAMOTIX simulation, I noticed that there were some rough spots right along the comfort, this arm relief contour area. So I created a second finishing pass, just like I did on the back of the guitar in the tummy cut area. And this will further clean that up and get it really smooth. And then, of course, I will finish this off by doing a perimeter cut to smooth out the sides of the body. And as you can see, if you look closely, you can see where the line kind of makes this jump over. That's where it's going over the tabs that I've positioned around the body to keep the body in place while it's being carved out. So once this is done, the body itself is completely finished. And the next couple of files I have may not make a lot of sense initially, but what I'm going to be doing is making my truss rod cover as well as my control cavity cover. And the first one you see here, this is the Highline logo, which is going to be carved as a pocket into the truss rod cover. So what I'll do is I'll carve this out, and this operation takes about 4 minutes. Once that's done, I will then carve the perimeter shape of the truss rod cover you see here. And I know this may not make a lot of sense, but this is kind of what the truss rod cover looks like after it's been completely finished. Then I move on to my control cavity cover, which is kind of a similar situation. I'm going to carve the Highline Guitars logo into the middle of the control cavity cover, and this will be inlaid. So I'll carve out the pocket for it, and this will take, there's two times here, 4 minutes and 12 minutes, because I'm using two bits to do this, a rough bit and then a finishing bit. So 4 minutes for the rough carve, 12 minutes for the finish carve. So we're talking about 16 minutes to carve out the Highline Guitars logo. And then when that's done, I will carve the perimeter shape of the control cavity cover, which you see here. And this will take about a minute. Then I'm going to remove this piece of wood, and I'll place a contrasting piece of wood, and I will cut out a mirror image of my logo. And this is cut to a depth that's slightly deeper than the pocket that I carved in the control cavity cover. What I'll do is I'll cut away this excess out here so that I have just this the logo within this rectangle. And then what I can do is flip it over and glue it into the pocket. When it dries, I'll cut away the excess with the bandsaw, sand it smooth, and this is what the control cavity cover will look like when it's completed.
Well, all right, that's a brief overview of the 26 different carving operations that I have to perform with my CNC machine in order to make a guitar. Now, that doesn't mean that it's always 26 carving operations. It really depends on the complexity of the guitar that I've designed. But for the Bravo single cutaway with some comfort contours on both the front and the back, that's about what it takes, 26 different carving operations. And in future episodes, as I said before, I'm going to try to explain each of these in more detail. And what I'll probably do is I'll break it out into a video on the fretboard, a video on the neck, and then a video on the body. And I'll try to explain exactly what bits I'm using, the feeds and speeds and all that kind of stuff. So stay tuned for that. But in the meantime, I hope you found this video to be useful. If you have any comments or questions, post them down below. Be sure to give me a thumbs up. And you know, as always, if you don't subscribe to my channel but like videos on building guitars, make sure to hit that subscribe button. And if you want to show my channel some support, head over to eGuitarPlans.com and purchase a plan. And if you don't want to purchase a plan, you can also show support by purchasing a Highline Guitars t-shirt. And there's a merch shelf down below that you can click on one of the different designs and make a purchase. Or if you can't see that shelf, there's a link in the description below. So until the next episode, take care, stay safe, and I'll see you soon.